tend to act surprised.
Oh, please, it's fine. Listen, he can still get it as far as I'm concerned.
What is he, almost 60?
No, how dare you?
Still get it.
He's 52.
Probably about 50. Oh, okay.
He's 52. How dare you?
Yo, Emily, you better chill.
Beat him up.
So the most successful rap artist of all time to date is a singer.
Let's talk about it. Who's that?
Is an R&B singer. Drake.
Oh, no, I knew you were going to say that.
Oh, okay. Now, see, Drake is interesting because Drake is both. Like,
I was just going to say, Drake is both.
Yeah, Drake is, undoubtedly.
Well, he's not a very good R&B singer.
No, he's not.
There's like one or two songs.
You know
what? You know what? For R&B, that's how these R&B cats sound nowadays. Like, to me, he's not any worse than, you know, I mean, you always hear me say R&B died in the mid-90s.
Well, what I mean is, if Drake had come out and never rapped and had just come out with an R&B album, we wouldn't be talking about Drake. I think what I'm trying to say is that Drake is very awesome with his fusion of singing and rap. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And his marketing, too.
Yeah, like I have no problem. Like, one of my favorite bands, not just rap groups, bands of all time. Right, I put them right up there with Queen as far as my enjoyment of them is Bone Thugs and Harmony.
Oh, actually, I was going to mention specifically because of their
understanding of music and harmony with hip with rap. You know what I mean?
So I've got a confession to make about Bone Thugs and Harmony.
Don't even say it, man. I'm gonna be mad. Uh-oh.
It's nothing like that. It's just that I was really sleeping on the harmony aspect of them.
Oh, wow. Like,
but maybe specifically on Busy Bone. Like, I didn't realize that I didn't even tell you what that means yet. You guys, I'll relax for a second. I guess I didn't realize that even like as a singular, like as a solo artist, that one of them alone could still like hold a note so well. Although they, you know, just kind of blended well and kind of like did the kind of sing-songy rap thing. But then I heard Busy on a solo record, and I'm like, oh, okay, like he still gets busy. Like, no.
That's the reason why Busy was like one of my favorite, that like high soprano that he would do. Yo, listen, bro.
Yeah, to be honest.
He was melodic with it too.
Yeah, well, I guess that's the thing. To be honest, I always had love for Bone, but I never got into them enough to be able to differentiate between the members. But now,
Crazy put it all together.
Okay.
Crazy was really like a genius musically. He understood music. Like, this guy played guitar, played several different instruments, and he's the one who did all the arranging. Crazy Bone.
Which one is Crazy?
He's the
light skin one.
That's Lazy. Busy is the lightest one with the high voice.
Right.
Lazy and Crazy are brothers. Lazy is the light-skinned brother. Crazy is the dark-skinned brother.
And you know, that's the other thing, is their names don't necessarily match their personalities either. Because Crazy, like, there's one who ended up going to jail, which to me, he probably should have been Crazy.
Yeah, he went to jail. But Flesh just wasn't ever there enough because he was always in and out of prison. Wish is the heavy set.
The dark heavy set, too, yeah.
Yes, the skinny dark one is Crazy. Yeah, the skinny dark one is Crazy Bone, and he's the genius of the group. Like, he's the one who put everything together.
He's the skinniest, almost skeletal face looking one, right?
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Okay. He's the bones.
He's like laid back. Yeah, now I'm like, how is that dude? That dude's not crazy.
As crazy as foul and speak less doesn't mean my gun is for weakness. That's what he said it. Like, just because crazy quiet and speak less
don't mean
my gun is for weakness. You know what I mean?
Right. Sometimes it's the quiet people you gotta watch.
Oh, believe me, I know that. I definitely know that.
And they made great choices, like remaking like Friends and, you know, I mean, just some of the stuff that their second album, that double album, the Art of War album is just a masterpiece to me.
You mean like Friends, How Many of Us Have Them?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that second album, their third album, their third studio album was a double album called Art of War.
Oh, just of course, you know, I love the stuff they did with Pac.
Yeah, that's on Art of War.
Yeah.
It's on the Art of War album. And then remaking If I Could Teach the World to Sing, you know what I mean, and turn it into a hip-hop song like this. Just Bone is just a great, and it's timeless music.
You know,
because they didn't just go straight hip-hop.
So Busy has his little show on YouTube now that I watched.
I didn't know that.
He tells little stories about things that happened, like they had their little beef with Wu-Tang back in the day, which mm-hmm. I had no idea about until I heard Busy tell the story. I just found out about this. Like,
well, Ray and Ghost ago. Didn't like anybody, so.
Oh, they had inner beef. They had inner beef caused by the label, which, I mean, it didn't go anywhere, but like Tamika Wright, Easy's wife, tried to get Busy to leave.
Oh, and they were talking about killing, was it Shug's night wife they talked about wanting to
kidnap her? Yeah, they had beef with her too.
Yeah.
Yeah, you remember Easy discovered them in LA. Well, he had them come out to LA.
Yep.
And at the time, Easy had beef with Shug. Remember,
didn't have beef with Suge Knight.
Nah, but he had real beef. Like, they used a RICO law. When Easy ended up winning the beef. Like, it got physical, but they used RICO law. No, that was what they used against Murder, Inc. They brought in a lawyer. So that's why when Easy spit that line on his comeback album, which didn't really make it, that he made 25 cent off everything that Dre sold, or that Death Row sold, he did.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
It was he legally made off everything they sold.
Well, wow. There was that scene in the NWA movie, like where Suge was basically like
he muscled him out of Dre contract.
Yeah, exactly. Suge
injected him with AIDS, I think,
because he said it.
Now we're getting to the. Now we're getting
that's
to
conspiracy,
the
even though he said it. Yeah, he did say it on Arsenio.
That. Didn't he say it?
Like, yeah, on Arsenio.
Oh, I thought it was
Johnny Carson. Shook has said a lot of shit.
Yeah.
Including
yeah.
That Tupac is still alive all the time. Shook is not the
hanging out on Elvis's on Elvis's Hidden Island.
Yeah, Shook is not the poster boy for truth. That's for sure.
Elvin started the island and they all go there. Like the whole 27 club is there, like Kurt Cobain is there.
Nice.
Amy Winehouse.
Hendrix is there, Winehouse. Prince is there.
Janet Joplin, all of them.
Yeah.
It's very
Marilyn Monroe.
Well, of course she's there.
Marilyn Monroe.
Of course she's there.
Michael.
Why wouldn't she be with Elvis? Like,
yeah, they're all there.
Very universally thought by the streets that the portrayal of Eazy-E was wrong because he never got.
Hold on, Mike. I just want to say Jimmy Hoffa funds that island, Sam. Anyway.
Of course. Yeah.
That, Eazy-E never got punked by Suge because Eazy-E just wasn't built that way and he was a real street dude. It's like universally.
Yeah, that doesn't mean he ain't get beat up. I'm not saying he did one way or the other because I just don't, you know.
Well, I mean, it's just universally thought that if what they portrayed in that movie happened to Eazy-E, there would have been like a war. Like,
there would have been trouble.
Yeah,
yeah. It would have been real trouble. Like, it just couldn't have gone down like that.
Well, I think that you got to remember, too, that Hollywood, like, over-dramatizes things.
Shook's the book.
They admitted that they certainly embellished the story. Like, they admitted it.
Yeah.
Cuban, Dre, and all of them did.
Suge is universally known as the boogeyman, and most people don't really know the street stuff. So, like, to tell the average person that Suge did something like that, it's easy to digest unless you really
and it makes a good movie.
Yeah.
Well, the average Joe Schmo not from the street, I should say.
I mean, it wasn't like he got punked in the movie, though.
Yeah, you know, but even the way
he
they
got roughed
it
up a little,
like,
though.
Yeah, even
getting beat up and getting punked is two different things, though.
Yeah, but even the way they portrayed it has been universally debunked by like everyone that was like around that circle.
I mean, like, in the movie, they made it seem like he injected it.
Did they go there in that movie?
I was about to say, what, you saw some hidden scenes? You got the DVD. You got the DVD cut.
No. The scene where he went into the studio.
Oh.
Long pause here.
Be careful! I'm gonna give you something you can't give back. And then they jumped him. And then the next segment, he was in the hospital. He was sick. So they insinuated that that's what happened in the movie.
Well, that wasn't the next segment. A lot happens. Remember they met up at the club?
Yeah, a whole bunch happened before that.
He was sick when they met up, but he ain't tell them.
But I'm saying he was sick, but
he
started to see the sickness after he got jumped. They started showing that he was getting sick. And he was coughing and everything. And he wound up in the hospital.
I know. You know what never made sense to me, though, about that? Is that I feel like he had to have been living, like, with undetected HIV for a while. Because I feel like that, like, and maybe
his wife didn't catch it.
Yeah, maybe it was different, though, back then. But, like, I feel like it wouldn't progress so fast. Like,
yeah, it happened so fast, no one expected it. I remember walking back high school. I remember walking back from high school with headphones on, hearing about it. And I was just, like, quite surprised.
I was in the Army. I was hurt because I grew up idolizing Eazy-E and NWA. Like, I was West Coast to my core. Because of Eazy-E and NWA.
Yeah, quite surprised.
But it's like, scientifically, I feel like, and I guess maybe it could have progressed that quickly back then because we didn't have like the drugs that we have now. But I feel like even back then.
Yeah, they should have seen it. They should have seen him.
Yeah. Sick. I feel like, but it is a little bit.
A lot of cases, sickness is relative to psychology, too. Like, a lot of times people will be walking around totally fine and healthy and get a diagnosis, and the knowledge of said diagnosis contributes to their deterioration faster.
That's true.
That really happens. I've seen it. I worked in a hospital, seen it all the time. Like, you walk into the hospital and you're good. You've been living your life like you good because you didn't know that you are walking around with this potentially deadly disease. And then you find out, and psychologically, you stay, and this ain't conspiracy, this happens to people all the time. And next thing you know, 6 months later, you're a totally different person. Like, you done withered away.
Well, that's what happened to my father-in-law. Surgeons
used to tell me all the time, the success rate of the surgeon depends on the will, as much as on what they do physically, it also depends on the willpower of the patient.
Right.
Yeah. Their state going into the surgery contributes to the outcome. And I just say it all the time. It's the reason why stress physically affects us. Stress is psychological. But it physically affects us.
And it's another reason too why people in certain neighborhoods, I think, are having higher incidence of COVID than in others, because they live with chronic stress due to like the shitty hand that they have been handed, ostensibly.
Yeah. I mean, people break out in rashes, they hyperventilate, there's all kind of physical signs of stress, which is psychological. I can recall literally one particular day was just a particularly hard day for me because two of my patients died. One of them was getting ready to be discharged from CCU. Both of them were in CCU. One of them was getting ready to be discharged that day from CCU. Was standing at my desk talking to me perfectly fine that morning and was dead by noon. Went, took a nap in the bed and lay down in his bed and was dead. The other one was up and about and died in the you know how they have the so every floor, every critical care unit has its own little waiting room where like people can come sit with their family members. Died in the waiting room with their family member. Both patients being ready to discharge, both the same day. They literally coded them on the floor in the waiting room.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
I mean, that's, you know, just, it happens. You know what I mean? It's a hospital. We're talking in a critical care unit at that particular time. But these are people that were getting ready to be discharged for things that, you know, like, you can go home now. You're good. You know what I mean? We're not even sending you to a step-down unit. We're sending you home. And they're dead. The guy goes and lays down in his bed and he's dead.
Well, that's kind of true. Like, some people don't, I think some people, like, don't notice anything's wrong with them, like, until they're told something's wrong with them as well.
Yeah, my uncle walked around for a week with having had a heart attack and had to have bypass surgery. He just had chest pain and he was just taking it. He lived, he didn't die. But he had to have, he's still alive, but he had to have bypass surgery.
Well, no, Misha's
sorry
dad.
Sorry to hear that.
Misha's dad walked around.
Oh, he's good. This
for,
was years.
God knows how long Misha's dad walked around with cancer. And by the time that they found it, like, it was already stage four because he just hadn't really noticed it before. He was walking around going about his life.
And I bet once they told him, it was like a rapid deterioration.
Once they told him he was dead in a year.
I'm sorry to hear that.
I always think about this when I think about that movie with Dudley Moore, 6 weeks, or was it 9 months, where he meets the girl and her daughter, and he like falls in love with the daughter, like not in love with her like that because he's in love with the girl. It came out in the 80s, but the daughter,
sounds like
the daughter is
more of a compelling.
I think it's 9 months, but the daughter is dying. And he doesn't know, and he like develops this relationship with this girl, and you get to realize that the daughter is like this awesome. I remember the movie, she's like super awesome. She's a teenager, she's not a kid. You know what I mean? But like it comes out that she only has like this period of time to live. And then like the moment she begins, like she's having all this fun, and the moment it really sets in, she begins to rapidly deteriorate. Mm.
Sustainable. Oh man.
Why are we doing this? Let's go back to
Can't
we go back to hip hop?
Yeah.
Can't we go back to like something positive?
I bought
you're
drink.
The one with the Punisher shirt on.
No, it's Jack Skellington.
Oh, from
the
Nightmare Before Christmas.
Yeah.
To attest to why all these rappers are singing now.
Yeah, Dreidel, yeah.
I can't say Drake was the first.
He wasn't the first, but because he's the most successful currently, all the new rappers that are coming in, that's why they're all singing.
Because Ja Rule certainly was quite good at it.
Yeah, he actually had a voice without autotune.
I mean, he wrote like some of the best R&B songs.
Let's not get carried away.
Uh-oh.
He wrote some good R&B songs. That was his great album. His real talent was songwriting.
I mean, I just don't want to go as far as saying he had a good voice.
That he did have a good voice. We're not saying great.
Yeah, no one said he was Luther Vandross.
A good voice? I mean, come on.
He could harmonize.
Where would
sure.
I be without you? That's a good voice?
He could harmonize.
Dollar bugging. Where would I be without you? Holla. That's a good voice to you?
Yeah,
you're not talking singers, baby. You're talking singing rapper.
Yeah, we're talking melodic rap.
Good voice. I mean,
yeah,
I'll say
I think Vini Vedi Vici is a good example of him having that album, especially the joint where he's like, in my racing is time, I can't stop running through the red.
No, but I think I heard him in like
that wasn't his only vocal tone. Like that's not, he chose different types of, like, he didn't always sing like that. I just told you one where he didn't sing like that at all. He definitely just sang regular when he was like, in my race against time, I can't stop running through the red light, living my life. Even if I'm getting too high, I'ma keep running through the red light. Living my life. The Vini Vedi Vici album. His first album.
I never heard that song.
Yeah, he definitely had different. You're right. I'm not screaming that he was great. I thought he could harmonize. I didn't say that. I mean, you know, there are a lot of people who, there's a reason why, like, back in the day, they had, like, five-part harmony and not everyone sang. Like, if you listen to New Edition, all of them couldn't really sing, right? They just had good voices.
Well, they could definitely sing better than
John. Yeah, they could, for sure. But how many of them could really hold a solo? And yes, for sure, they could sing better than Ja Rule. No argument.
Solos are definitely not for everyone.
I mean, you had the one guy in Boyz II Men who couldn't sing at all. but he just couldn't sing. The bass, who never sang. He just would talk.
Right.
I think they just had him there because he was their boy. You know what I mean?
You mean he never sang a solo?
He never sang.
He was sitting on bass the whole time.
He's like, and all the Philly sticks you can eat.
His voice was there the whole time. That whole body here.
It just wasn't good. It was just okay.
Well, you just never heard him by himself because that wasn't his deal. It was just the body.
I mean, I really feel like he was their boy, and we're bringing you with us, bro. Because if you saw them, saw them in later years when they did reunion shows, like it was just the three of them. Like he wasn't.
They were good friends. They did right by him. They were being good friends.
Well, actually, I'll tell you what it is. He could probably fight, right? Like four guys from Philly. Like
three of them were probably nerds.
And even if they weren't, like
John Stockman was a nerd.
Even if you need. You need that one guy who could fight. He was like the Sheik Luch of Boyz II Men.
Okay.
He was the dude who could. He was the biggest dude who could fight.
He's the guy who could fight. Like everybody messed with us.
Just like Thug Life. Your man with the funny voice, Psych, Big Psych. That dude can't rap for shit. But he could fight.
The man with the funny voice.
You know, I think something can be said though. For Boyz II Men being one of the greatest singing groups of all time, and one of the members couldn't sing, like that to me speaks to something. You know what I mean? Like, man, that's so many hits.
I don't know. I don't know about your big man couldn't sing thing. I think he blended so well. You just didn't realize what you were hearing.
When you say he blended so well, you never got the smooth bass line. You never got the smooth bass anything. It was always him blending. He was always just him blending. And every other group that had a bass, you would at least get some bass vocal. Even if they weren't great, you still got a little.
Yeah, like
not necessarily a solo, but just a little.
Yeah, like the Tramps.
Yeah.
Like someone like that. Yeah.
You didn't get nothing from him but him blending.
I don't get what you mean.
I don't know any other way to say it.
I mean, if you're not talking about
you didn't
about
hear
solo,
him alone. That's kind of
what a solo is.
But you didn't hear like a bass. But no, what I mean is like you didn't hear like a specific like bass line that jumped out at you. Like it's like you heard him, but he was blended and he was covered up by the crowd.
And it was more than that. It was more than that, actually. Like anytime he even got a line by himself, he didn't sing. He just spoke. Yeah. So, and he rarely sang with them too. It was like, or if they did, it was like, yeah. I mean, maybe he did sing with them, but they were all like over him. He was definitely like, yeah. Yeah.
I mean, and I know because as someone who's jealous of people that can sing, I love singing. I listen. Like I'm listening for, okay, there's the guitar, there's the piano, there's this person's vocals. Like I listen to stuff like that. Like you take like New Edition, right? Like when Johnny Gill got there, you could tell the difference.
You knew
Johnny Gill didn't belong in New Edition. Like you could tell the difference right away. Like wait a minute,
this is a different.
This is like a when he first came on that Any Heartbreak joint, when he, all of a sudden he came in, he was like, everybody. I'm like, oh man, they never had a vocalist like this before. You know what
they
I'm
were
saying?
Like, they were like kids. Like, yo. They were like kids, and he was like a grown ass man.
Yo, my man came in, was like, everybody. I'm like, oh man, what's going on here? Like, this dude is singing. Yeah. Like, they're harmonizing, and this dude is singing. Like, yeah, singing.
They're doing, it's like they're doing the boy band cute thing. And he comes in with like a grown ass.
Yo, voice. You know the song I'm talking about, because the whole song changed. It was like that Any Heartbreak tour joint when he first joined. And they did the whole little, people say we can't give love it, but we're far away from home. And then all of a sudden, like halfway through the song, the spotlight come on and you see the smoke and he'd be like, everybody. I'm like, wait a minute. Hold on. Hold on.
When this dude, the rest of them are singing soprano.
Yeah. They're riding their bikes and all of them are on scooters riding to the mansion with the girls, and not Johnny Gill.
Yep.
Johnny Gill's in a dark room somewhere with smoke and strobe lights.
Yep.
And he's just like, everybody. I'm like, uh-oh. What just happened here?
Johnny Gill's pulling up in a nice vehicle, and he's got like scenes with like cognac and a robe on.
Yeah, right. something very like soigné and like a little dangerous.
I'm like, yo, and I grew up on New Edition. Johnny Gill, when he got, I'm like, I really could listen, because I thought High Five was, as a group, like I thought they had the best bass singer for like that type of boy band group at the time.
Mm-hmm.
Like their bass singer was just really good. All of them were really good, but their bass singer was particularly good. And then Johnny Gill. And I'm like, oh. Yes. And then
Johnny Gill definitely would not have, would have felt really out of place on Candy Girl. So.
Yeah, especially when he's dropping songs like my. I'm like, what?
Yeah.
But here's the important question. Was his voice as deep as the guy who sings Carmen Sandiego?
That's my joy. I love that song.
Oh.
She's a sticky finger picture from Berlin to Belize. She's hitching for a ride on a steamboat to China.
Somewhere in the world is Carmen Sandiego.
Damn.
That's my joy. I'm sorry. I used to love acapella. So when that joint used to come on, I used to rush home from school to watch it.
Oh,
just
nice.
For the opening theme song. Where nice. In the world is
Carmen Sandiego?
Mike, like, what are we doing here? Who is Carmen Sandiego?
That's how I learned geography.
Right.
That's how a lot of us learned geography growing up at that age. Yeah.
But I was laughing because somebody put all of like the old Carmen Sandiegos on YouTube. Like, somebody must have spent a lot of time digitizing their old VHS tapes. Mm. But like, it's freaking hilarious, because then they'll be like, and your choices are Yugoslavia, Albania.
Mm-hmm.
Or it'll be like, your choices are USSR.
There's another one I'm partial to, another song I'm partial to. I actually posted it on Facebook a little while back, maybe a year ago. But it's Butterfly in the Sky.
Reading Rainbow.
I can fly twice as high.
Oh, wow.
Take a look. It's in a book. Reading Rainbow. Rainbow.
Oh, that's all that's a good song. Read.
What's that?
Have you heard the DMX version?
No.
DMX did a Reading Rainbow. Oh God,
that's brilliant to me. I think that's awesome.
Okay, yeah, no. I have to.
Yeah, you have to check it out.
Like, me too. I gotta hear it.
I know, right?
What is he like? Butterfly in the sky.
Read a book.
Butterfly in the sky.
Yeah, it's a good time.
I can try twice as high.
Of course, yeah.
Take a look. It's in a book. Reading Rainbow.
Yeah. That's awesome. No, I just keep thinking of Jay Farrow when he was on SNL, and he was just like, you know, he was like basically kind of like a throwback to Eddie Murphy with all his impressions. And you know, when he would do like, when he would show up on like the, they used to do like the celebrity Christmas album, and Jay Farrow would come up doing DMX, and he'd be like, oh, Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer had a very shiny nose. What?
Yeah, oh yeah, I remember that.
That was my point. DMX and my dog's bite.
Yeah, exactly.
My nigga, rhyme all night. That was my joint.
Yeah.
So have you seen the little documentary show the Lox came out with, Living Off of Experience? DMX?
I haven't. You told me about it, though.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, he's Earl Simmons.
Mm-hmm. Who?
No, I said he's another one, Earl Simmons. I was just going on about earlier about how so many rappers have, like, the most, like, normal names.
Who's Earl Simmons?
That's DMX's real name.
Oh, yeah. Okay. For some reason, I'm thinking like Joseph and Russell Simmons. I'm like, Earl?
Oh, sure. Brother?
No, sure. We were saying, this is before he came on, we were saying how like they all have like the most like plain Jane names.
Fat
Joe?
Like James Todd Smith.
No, Fat Joe actually has an uncommon name.
His name is Joe.
Joseph Cartagena.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is not common.
That's not. Well, I mean.
It's not common.
Cartagena.
Yeah.
But.
Joe is pretty common.
Joe is pretty common, but it's not. But his last name isn't like Rodriguez or something, which is Smith in Spanish-speaking countries.
Okay.
Like, you know what I mean? Like, there's some names, like, that's what I mean. Like, you know, like, that are so common. They're, like, certain countries equivalent to Smith.
Yeah.
Like, say, for example, in Spanish-speaking countries, like, Garcia or, like, Rodriguez, Hernandez, they're all, like, equivalent to R. Smith and Jones and Brown.
Or Muhammad's, like, equivalent to, like, Michael.
Yeah.
Or like people in majority Islamic countries, like the last name Khan, for example. Like, I've taught like it's like Smith. Like, I've taught so many like kids with the last name Khan from Bangladesh.
Yep, and in space too.
Yep.
I was gonna say Khan is more of a Asian, like Indian. Mm-hmm. Pakistan type last name than it is more Arabic.
Bengali.
Yes.
Yeah.
Misha had a student whose last name was Khan, and he was late for a test one time, and Misha just looked up at the kid walking in the door, and he yells, "Khan!"
Nice.
If my last name was Khan, my MC name would be like Khan Artist or. You know, Khan, you know what I mean? Yeah. Or Khan the artist, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Did the kid get the reference?
I don't think the kid got the reference because the kids were too young to get the reference.
Right.
My brother.
Did you say, like, Khan, feel my wrath?
They don't, yeah, exactly. My kids don't get my references, though, either. Like, they don't know who Beavis and Butthead were.
Oh, well.
Oh, man.
Their loss.
Well, some of them did, but I called some kids acting like fools, Beavis and Butthead, one time, and they looked at me like I have five heads.
I mean, don't even get me started on the amount of kids that I don't even realize. Like, it doesn't occur to me how many people just never seen Star Wars.
Yep, they grew up. I know. I talked to like all my friends, like who have kids. They're all like,
but even the new ones too, or no?
I mean, the new ones are, when I'm like, have you ever seen Star Wars?
You're talking about the originals.
A lot of my friends who have kids are all like about, they're all like at a certain age, right? They're, how old are they? They're all like, okay, this is when we showed them Star Wars. Like, it's just, yeah, it's just, you have to, that's
no one
really,
born
that's
in the 21st century is like, what do you mean? It came out in 79? Like, I can't, you know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah,
no matter.
It was 79 or 77?
It was 77, but that's fine.
Yeah, okay. You know, either way, you know, it's like, they're not, they're what we thought was dope special effects. They're like, really?
Speaking of which, my birthday is coming up September 8th, Tuesday.
Oh, we're going to have to do a show and serenade you.
Yes, with singing.
What? Serenading? What's serenading? What, who's getting serenaded? Your, whoa, what?
His birthday is coming up.
Oh, my birthday's coming up. I'm
here. So we have to serenade.
Oh, your birthday's coming up. Okay. Yeah,
yeah. You know, I just want to make it clear for everyone else on here that isn't me, Mike, and Kelsey. Mm. When we do happy birthday, we do the MLK version.
Oh yeah, I was gonna do that too.
I wish you mean the Stevie Wonder version.
Stevie Wonder, yeah.
Yes, which was for MLK.
Right. Nah, I get you. Most people call it the Stevie Wonder version, but that's okay. We get what you're talking about.
I mean, you know, it's just so much prettier when he sings it. So, yeah, I get, of course.
It's the version we do. Happy birthday to you.
So yeah, I'll join in. I'd be happy to join in.
But we can also do the traditional 1800s happy birthday as well.
Are you one? Are you two? Are you three? No.
It is the most popular song of all time in America.
Really? You know what?
We can eschew tradition, and we don't have to go through the traditional version.
He's like, no, we're not going to do the most popular song of American song of all time.
Well, you can save it. I'm next in line. Save it for me.
Yeah.
He's like, I don't want the black version.
Wait, say what?
I don't care. But if
he
you
says,
don't
save
want
the traditional one for her. She's like, I don't want that happy, but that Stevie Wonder version.
I don't care, actually.
There's enough representation going on in this country.
They're ruining our neighborhoods with their lawlessness. And oh, my God.
Who's ringing my doorbell?
Mm-hmm. Oh, at this baby, hour?
This baby's mama, my goddaughter. Mm-hmm. I guess I should go open it and not let her stand on the porch.
That's weird. It sounded like the bell rang after he said that. Anyone else catch that?
No, because it's one of those ones that goes dun 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 dun. So we heard the second half.
I want to get a dun dun dun.
Hey. Oh, you want your doorbell? You want your doorbell to play Beethoven's Fifth Symphony?
Yeah, it would be awesome.
No, the A plus. You want it to play the A plus song, don't you?
What's that?
You don't remember the A plus song that used that?
No.
Da-da-da-da. Nope. You got to Google it. It's A plus. That was like his one good song.
Who's A plus?
Yeah.
A young rapper from the 90s.
I don't know him.
You'll remember the song, trust me.
I'm thinking you're talking about the gas station from Buffalo.
Yeah, that's what I thought you were talking about the gas station too.
Like, oh, they had a commercial with Beethoven.
I'm gonna show you A plus.
I'm not the only person who thought it was the gas station, yes.
Is he from Queens?
That's a good question. I don't really know. You know, with some of these young cats, I don't really be knowing where they're from like that.
Well, you said the 90s.
Yeah, no, he was a young cat, though. I just don't
know. He must not have made it.
He had his one hit. He was like, let him live. He had his little one hit wonder.
Let him live.
Who is this? It was this?
His name is A plus. He's getting an F from obscurity for me.
Yeah, that's what I was gonna say.
Guys, so I thought maybe Emily would know.
I don't. A+. Yeah,
I was 10 years old. Why would I know this?
Emily's like, don't put this.
No,
on
I thought you were 90s. I thought you knew your 90s hip hop, but that's okay.
Well, I know.
Oh,
not the one-hit wonders.
Bro, God, you just threw the whole lamp, Flavie. Jesus.
Damn. They're hating on my man A plus, and I'm gonna have to show him how your boy does his homework.
Once again, in middle school, I only knew what made it to MTV.
Okay.
There wasn't no Hot 97 upstate.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's all right. That's all right. Are you guys seeing this?
We can't do this. We can't play this while you're recording, Flavy. Flavy, you're recording, right?
I mean, I think we got the point.
What's happening?
I'm scared.
Yeah, weren't we supposed to, like, be hearing something? Flav, you there?
Huh? Yeah, I'm here.
Weren't we supposed to play a song?
Oh, you don't hear it? Something?
No.
No.
Oh, what the hell?
And you're recording. And we've lost it.
No, I stopped recording.
No, and then you started recording again. It says recording in the top left corner of my screen. Mm-hmm.
Subjected to
that didn't ring a bell, Emily?
No, I told you. I was in middle school. If it wasn't on MTV, I didn't know it.
No, that didn't could have been on MTV. That could have been on MTV.
It didn't punch any keys. Didn't do anything for me.
Not during... Well, let me rephrase that. I don't think they ever played it on MTV, like, in the afternoon hours. Not because it was bad, but because they just played, like, boy bands over and over.
So now we get to catch your reaction of seeing that for the first time. What do you give it? Do you give it an A+, or do you give it?
I give it a 0.
Oh, ouch. That's... You're supposed to be encouraging the kids, not failing them.
Not those kids.
Ish didn't get to hear too much of it, so we can't really...
That was on purpose.
So, Sam, what did you think of A+?
I have no opinion.
No opinion? All right.
Yeah.
Well, you know, not a lot of people were sampling Beethoven. Back in the '90s,
that's true.
So
that's true, but he failed miserably because he didn't have any talent.
Oh, that's not true. His flow was pretty good. You gotta.
Flavius gets to dictate to us what's good. After we've been saying things are just good. I don't know if you'd call it good. I want to quote you, Flav.
I don't know if you'll call that good. You can quote me as saying A+ was good.
I'll quote you as saying I don't know if we'll call that good.
Oh, shots fired. I'm gonna hide under the table for cover.
I'm with Sam. I have no opinion, which is not good.
That song was a hit for a reason. That's all I'll say.
Huh.
Because of marketing, that's why.
I'd say Ja Rule's a better singer than that guy's a rapper.
Well,
yeah, you can keep that.
I would say I give it a 69, but that's passing.
I can say that. I'm sure that I can say, okay, Emily, I saw what you did there. I'm sure that I can say more people paid money to hear Ja Rule sing poorly than they did to hear A+ rap well.
Well, yeah, I mean, you haven't heard of it. I mean, the poor kid was like, you know, he was like underground. Kid. Like,
he's just Ja Rule.
The poor kid.
Ja Rule sold out. So, yeah, everyone got to hear him. This kid.
He sold out or he bought in. Like, come on. That's, you know, subjective.
Whatever he did. A+ was just doing it, you know.
He sold out. That video certainly looked like A+ was struggling to sell out. Come on, he sampled Beethoven.
Yeah, that was, nobody was really doing that.
Like, He sampled Beethoven. No kid coming up with Scuff Kicks and Queensbridge relates to Beethoven. Who was he? Who was he trying to market? Like,
yo. Yeah. Well, first of all, you gotta think like he didn't have to. They didn't have to pay for that sample, right? Samples were probably getting, you know, were getting expensive at that time.
Well, it was probably public. It was public domain.
Yeah, it was public domain, and it was a decent clip of that sample. You got to think about it for that time. Like, we hadn't heard that, you know. So like,
still haven't heard it. I would have never heard it if you hadn't decided to play the 1 second that I had. It was the most unbearable 1 second of my life. Just so you know.
Yeah. So mm-hmm. he can out rap a lot of these little rappers. I think he was out. he was actually born in Hempstead.
Oh, I'm not. I'm not sold on your conviction.
So he's from Long Island. He's a fake.
Well, I'm not even concerned.
Well, here we go. Here we go again with this weird idea of what's real and what's fake. First of all, have you ever been to Hempstead? Like, Hempstead is realer than like 90%.
He's like, you know how they get down in Beverly Hills? Like, Hempstead, New York, they don't play.
Have you ever
Hempstead
heard?
Is dangerous.
They don't play in white lanes.
Have you ever heard the word joke? Actually,
you're not buying into Mike, are you? You're not buying into this, Emily. Next thing you know, he's gonna tell you how gangster it is in Beverly Hills.
Well, Prodigy's from Hempstead.
Prodigy's from Queens.
Wrong. Don't ever in your life try to tell me about Mobb Deep. Try again.
Then why were they?
Prodigy rap queens. Used to get beat up from people who didn't like him because he wasn't actually from the projects.
And but Prodigy did rap from, queens.
Yes, and he was actually from Long Island, aka Hempstead.
Or was he just born there and moved to Queens?
No, he rap queens.
Well, yeah, some people say he shouldn't have been repping it, and he used to get into a lot of fights.
Yeah, but there. The people that mattered in Queens let him rep Queens. He did get in beat, but the people that matter, like Nas, Nature, Nori, they let him rep Queens.
Nas.
You're right, Barbs. Mike. He did get Nas, he did. Nas very familiar with how Prodigy came up the whole nine, but they absolutely let him rep Queens. And he did get in problems
with people
that at least were the face of Queens, especially during that Brooklyn Queens beef.
We're on the same page. Just Emily tried to come for me, and I had to let her know.
But you don't hear no one saying I rep Hempstead, do you?
Just look into it. Trust me. Hempstead is, I mean, you're right. It doesn't sound cool to say I rep it, but a lot of rappers came from Long Island.
Method Man was born on Long Island.
LL rep Queens.
He didn't live there for any period of time.
LL rep Queens.
Well, LL rep Queens, yeah. But, repping and...
Well, LL Cool J was from Jamaica.
He was born on Long Island, but he repped Queens, yeah.
Right. LL rep Queens and Harlem, because he ran with Rich Porter and Elpo and them boys. But he also rep Queens.
Those are some heavy cats. Yeah,
LL was not no regular dude in the streets. You know what I mean? He wasn't like, he was like a real dude in the streets. Like, he ran with Rich Porter and Elpo and all them, and from Harlem, and he rep Queens. So you already know, if you riding with that crew from Harlem, and you're repping Queens, like, you got, you know what I mean?
just so all the haters know, your boy A Plus on his first album, which I'm not gonna tell you the name of the album, lest I get more shit.
Yeah, I'd like to know the name of the album. Was it called like I Missed the Bus?
It's called the Latchkey.
The Wheels on the Bus.
It's called the Latchkey Child.
Oh my God, it's as bad as I missed the bus from Young MC.
That was Crisscross. Oh,
here we go. No, was it Crisscross?
I missed the bus. And it was something that I'll never, ever, ever do again. Yeah, that's okay. Crisscross. Okay. But the Latchkey Child featured contributions from Mobb Deep and Q-Tip, two people from Long Island. So, there you go.
And we need to know this because?
Because if you're hanging out with Mobb, you're hanging out with Mobb Deep and Q-Tip, you must have some credibility on the mic. Q-Tip and Mobb Deep aren't just throwing themselves on anybody's albums.
Well, just because you're hanging out with them doesn't mean you have credibility on the mic. I just want to say.
I mean, on their album is what I should have said. Instead of hanging out.
It doesn't mean you have credibility. It just means that the label threw the cash their way and they took
it. Okay, and why would they do that?
Because they like money.
Because they were getting paid.
No. But
what do you mean?
What did they expect? What did they expect to come out of that, though?
It's the same reason why Nas charged everybody, period, for a feature, no matter who they were, because he had been screwed over so many times in the industry.
The label thought A Plus was going to go somewhere, and other people rock with him. I remember this dude. Other rappers liked him. Other rappers thought he was dope for what he was.
Mike, you have this way of being the only person on the island.
Well, hey, man, I mean, it's not...
Like, you know what? My position here on this island is right.
It's not always fun
everyone else
solo
is.
Out here. Well, just because you guys...
You know what, though? As much fun as this is, I'm actually not going to... This is just me. Even though I didn't think much of it, I'm actually not going to take the position that Mike is wrong here just because I... only heard about 20 seconds of it. I don't know anything about it, so I'm not gonna so I'm gonna take a neutral Sam, position here on Sam, that one. That's my
all right,
Sam, you're choosing to be Poland or Switzerland right now.
I just want to speak to what Sam said
in this choice that he's choosing right now. I just want to say this real quick, Mike, and then let you go in. One thing that Sam said that was very, very telling there, Sam, that just outs you. It outs you.
Told me I was being Switzerland.
Sorry. I mean, it's that whole neutral thing. Maybe that's bad. I'm sorry. But
she said
Poland. I said Switzerland.
No, I said Switzerland.
But I said Poland. But what's telling, though, what's telling, though, Sam, is that you said, I've only heard 20 seconds. And that was the key phrase that you said, because you've only heard 20 seconds in your entire life. And
yes. And
we're talking almost 15 years later, you're finally hearing this 20 seconds, which speaks to what we've been saying. It kind of goes against everything that you have claimed to say.
Excuse me if I was a real hip hop head, and that I heard a song which reached the top 5 of the UK singles chart, number 63 of the US Hot 100 for 3 weeks, and was commercially successful in Germany and Japan. So, excuse me.
Now I feel like I'm watching Beavis, but he's like, you know, Beavis, he was top 5 of the UK.
Yeah, right.
I shouldn't have led with that one. It's also number 63 of the U.S. Hot 100 for 3 weeks.
Also, he said it with so much conviction, too. If I was a real hip-hop head, and I would... Someone who was top 5 in the U.K.
See, I'm just enjoying people...
The U.K. doesn't play,
not,
man. The U.K. is
I'm
about the real hip-hop.
I'm just enjoying not being the one whose taste is getting shat on.
Yeah, man.
Hey, man, the UK doesn't play. They like their real hip-hop over there. They don't play.
They do. They like their A-plus this in their...
And Germany and Japan. Okay.
Yep.
Other people, other noted appearances on his second album, Hempstead High. Again, not afraid to rep Hempstead. Include DeBarge. Include DeBarge.
DeBarge.
Right? Yep.
DeBarge.
The Lost Boys.
DeBarge, who was done.
Hey man, let's not shit on DeBarge, man. DeBarge had some.
We're not. They were just done. Times.
DeBarge had some rough times, but they were, you know.
They were gangster.
The Lost Boys and Cannabis. Come on, man. These are some great guest appearances he was able to do. They expected A Plus was going to do some things. That's all I'm saying. That's all I'm saying.
Did he? Did he do some things?
On the underground, yeah. On the underground. You know, but you had to be a real head. You had to be a real head.
Where did he place on the underground charts?
They don't really, you know, they don't really do it like that.
Oh, they don't do charts?
So the point is,
do they track CD sales out of the trunk? Is there any way that we can?
There might be.
He had his time. That's how we.
Did they buy YouTube views too?
They weren't doing YouTube back then.
You was rocking A Plus, Katie.
No, he was dope though.
This is Katie, fucking ruthless.
This is what we doing, this Katie. He was dope.
Fucking
now wait a minute. Just so you know, this is all going to be on record. You're shitting on someone who is one of the founding four members of Souls of Mischief. How dare you?
Sam, I do want to apologize to you about the polling reference, by the way.
That's fine.
I think it was in poor taste, and I didn't even consider that.
That's fine.
Souls of Mischief. How dare you?
The hieroglyphics. I accept your apology. It's all good.
The hieroglyphics, dude.
Founding member, huh?
Founding member.
Oh, my God.
Oh, wait a minute. Uh-oh.
This is ruthless.
Wait, sorry. That must be a different... Is that a different one?
Is it different A plus? Is it the A plus from Nas's crew?
Oh my god!
I think that's AZ, who more people have heard of. A
plus. Oh yeah, you know what? There was another A plus.
Yeah,
he was a West Coast
from Queensbridge. Oh, I ain't hear of him either.
Those are West
Coast. Oh my god.
No, you haven't heard of it's okay, you haven't heard of hieroglyphics or Souls of Mischief.
Well, guess what Grady
better and better?
Guess what Grady didn't get as a hip hop artist. Guess what Grady didn't get?
Oh my god, this is
A plus.
He didn't get an A plus.
Souls of Mischief is one of the dopest hip hop songs ever.
Exactly. 93-2.
93-2 Infinity, yeah.
93-2.
Who?
Yeah.
Those
now, this is sad. Now you're just making yourself look bad.
No.
You never heard. You never heard of 93-2.
No.
This is how we chill in 93-2. This is how we chill in 93-2. This is how we chill in 93-2.
This is really bad.
Dude. I mean, it was West Coast though, so
it sounds like Chub Rock. Or E-40 or Chub Rock.
Well, first of all, Chub Rock, that's not a diss. Chub Rock,
no,
is dope too.
It just sounds like he was.
I guess you've never heard of Del the Fucking Homo Sapien either.
Yes, I have.
Okay, now you finally.
I've never heard of A plus.
Well, yeah, I mean, you would have heard of Souls of Mischief more than A plus. You're
throwing all these names out here.
The only one I haven't heard of is
he was just a member of the group.
He's a member of the group. But no bullshit, I am surprised you haven't heard of Souls of Mischief, and that's no bullshit.
Probably have, but I mean I've lost so much hip hop because the 90s was just like a renaissance, right?
Especially
if you were a hardcore head.
Yeah, the 93-2 would have stood out. If you hear it, it might jog your memory, but
you and I could talk about groups like the Beatnuts, and you know, someone who was as hardcore as you and I were might not ever know of the Beatnuts or Digging in the Crates, or you know what I'm saying? Like, and it wouldn't be their fault.
Not if they were as hardcore as we were. I mean, there might be songs that they didn't know, but if you're of a certain ilk, you know who the Beatnuts are.
Yeah, I mean, but that's how I was, and that's why I'm like A plus, dude. I go deep. We're talking Duck
Fine.
Down
A plus is fine.
And
yeah,
Raz Kaz, and you know what I mean.
Yeah.
And I don't know A plus.
No, that's fine. That's fine. He was more of a one hit wonder. So I'm, you know, I mean, it might have also been, and this is no, you know, this is no funny stuff. It might have also been you were overseas at the time. Because I feel like that was a one hit that was like, that was kind of big. But I guess, Katie, you don't.
I mean, you know, number five in the UK charts, you know.
But it was a West Coast. It was a West Coast song.
No, 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 no. We're going back. No, we're going back to A plus. That was from Hempstead now.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, yeah. Because you said you hadn't heard of him either, right?
I remember him being young.
Okay. Because, I mean, and most people would have remembered him.
He was a young rapper, like a little, not even a little kid rapper, but he was young, younger than most rappers.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Rapping Forte put him on?
He was East Coast. Rapping Forte. No, you're
talking about the East Coast A-plus.
Yeah, we're talking about the East Coast A-plus.
What, so now you have to be specific about which one you're talking about?
Well,
right, because he was such an underwhelming rapper that someone else could have the same name and it wouldn't even make a blip on the radar. It's not like there's two Jay-Z's running around.
Wait a minute. Now, there were two Biggie Smalls Tupac had a homie called Biggie Smalls. That's why you hear him on one of his songs say, "Biggie Smalls, God bless the dead." And then conspiracy theorists say, "Wait a minute, but Tupac died before Biggie, so why did he say R.I.P. to Biggie Smalls? Because he had another homie who was a West Coast dude named Biggie Smalls."
So, Mike, you're totally deflected. I stand on my point that there wasn't another rapper running around with a famous rapper's name.
Oh, Biggie Smalls?
Yeah, that's, or Jay-Z.
Okay,
but
okay.
All right.
Havoc and Prodigy.
Listen, if you remember, Biggie Smalls changed his name to Notorious Big because there was a band called Biggie Smalls that had the name first.
And again, there wasn't another rapper running around. Like, that's my point. That's my point is A-plus didn't even make a blip on the radar such that another rapper could be called A-plus.
Well, that's not true, but
well, there were two A-pluses. Well, there weren't two Jay-Zs.
The West Coast, he was in a group. And the group was known.
There were two Havoc and Prodigies.
Oh yeah, were there two Mobb Deeps?
No, there were two Havoc and Prodigies. One was a West Coast group.
Okay.
But still.
There were two Snoop Dogs.
There are two Snoop Dogs?
KD, that wasn't a band. That was the name of a character in a movie.
It was a character in a movie? I thought it was a band.
In the Sandlot?
No, 1975 movie called Let's Do It Again. In it, Biggie Smalls, played by Calvin Lockhart, was the leader of a gang. It wasn't
Bill Cosby's in that movie, right?
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
City Portier, I think.
Yes. And yeah. Lockhart sued, and Biggie was forced to change his official name to Notorious B.I.G.
Sam.
Yes.
What do you think about this nonsense?
I knew it was the reason you changed his name.
You mean, what does he think about the fact that it's still going on?
No. I think he wants to know what my opinion is on all of this. Or is Emily correct in the fact that this is still going on? What do you want to know?
I just want to know what you think about this nonsense as a whole, since you decided to be a neutral. You decided to be neutral.
Well, I mean, as I said before, I only heard 20 seconds of the song. So, you know, perhaps the fact that I hadn't heard of it before now, and I would have been around to remember I was, you know, listening to music and watching MTV and VH1 all the time during that age. If I had heard it, I didn't remember it. As far as the rest of it goes, in fact,
so we could say it was forgettable.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, if it was on MTV, neither of us saw it or remembered.
But you know what though? I'm gonna have to. But I will say this. Yeah, it did seem like a really. Yeah, it did seem like, you know, whatever, for whatever reason, it got overshadowed by other stuff. But that does go back to the point that we were making in like a group chat about how about things are heavily marketed and others are not. So maybe I would have to go back and rewatch it, and maybe I would have to wonder whether or not, like, why didn't he blow up more? Why wasn't there like, oh, but even then, Flavie also said that like people were bankrolling him because they were expecting him, or bankrolling him because they were expecting him to do great things. And
so based on that, it stands the reason that he probably wasn't good. But let me ask you a further question.
Okay.
Let me ask you one more question about that. This. So based on it does stands to my reason. It's subjective. So
have you ever heard of Jamal?
Hold on. I want to ask Sam another question real quick. So, you know, you were saying that you wonder why he might not have been memorable, and it causes me to question that, you know, with a song that has a Beethoven sample, you would think it would, you know, it would be more memorable, and yet somehow, as Mike said, no one else was doing that, right? So you would think it would be something that could stand out. And you know,
he did start a trend. More people did start using some of the classical samples.
Oh, because of after
him. Unless his entire point was to make a song that was just so terrible that we all had to, that we're all talking about it, thus giving him free publicity.
Well, I mean,
to be honest, like, I don't know that you're going to hear this one hit wonder and all of a sudden develop like this newfound appreciation for him. Like, if you didn't grow up like having had love for that song and that artist, you missed the boat. Like, you're not gonna sit here in 2020 and be like, "Oh damn,
the world missed out."
Y'all had a great.
Well, listen, I only heard 20. Look, I mean, okay, Ish is determined to.
Determined, yes.
Yeah, Ish seems determined to burn this house down, which is fine. But
already on fire.
Yeah, the roof is on fire. We don't need no water, but I do actually, because I'm coughing like crazy. However, yeah, no, again, it seems like he was onto something with the sampling, but mm-hmm. then when it came to the actual song, he was just copycatting like crazy. So it just kind of seemed like it was like a potential of something that went nowhere. But yeah,
like he didn't stand out enough, you mean?
Yeah. Like, it was, again, like the sampling was really cool, but then he looked like Mace's little brother or something, and it was just,
right.
like,